automatic in our soul.
Should be.
To just lift open hands to the Lord. And see that my heart is filled with praise. It should be automatic that the minute our feet touch the floor, we should rejoice and thank God for one more day. Sometimes it takes all day long for me to think about it. Lord, to let me see one more day. I wore no clothes in my right mind with a reasonable portion of the strength. But it took until 3 o'clock in the afternoon just to think about it. Took for granted that His goodness and His mercy is everlasting. But that's why my heart today is filled with praise. Father, in the name of Christ Jesus, we just pause right now, Lord, to reverence You as our Lord and as our Savior. Take time out, Lord, to just thank You for just this day. Thank You for looking beyond our faults and seeing to our needs. Tell somebody you almost happy to see him today. Let somebody know you almost my friend. You're almost my buddy. Almost thought about you. Almost. You almost crossed my mind. Head still turning.
No.
Chapter 6, 2 Samuel, chapter 6, beginning at verse number 20. That's 2 Samuel. It's chapter number 6.
You need help raising an ear, I'll come by.
Beginning at verse number 20. We got it?
Amen.
Maybe I'll stand for reading God's word. It reads, and David returned to bless his household, but Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, how the king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servants, his female servants, as one of vulgar fellow shameless uncovers himself. And David said to Michal, it was before the Lord who chose me above your father and all above his house, to appoint me as a prince over Israel, the people of the Lord. And I will celebrate before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this, and I will abase in your eyes. But by the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I shall be held in honor. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no children to the day she died. Amen. For thought this afternoon, I want to tag this passage of scripture, an outward expression of an inward impression. An outward expression of an inward impression. On last week, we looked at some of the football games, and to my dismay, the Pittsburgh Steelers did lose the football game on last Sunday. But as I was looking at the football game, I noticed that in the stands, there was a large contingent of Super Bowl Pittsburgh Steelers fans mixed in with New England Patriots fans. And they were all dressed in their team apparel. There was folks out there that had on no shirts, hat, or scarf, and it was freezing outside. They had painted on Patriots on their faces. They had steel imprints on their chest. They were letting everyone know that whom team they were supporting. And it was left without doubt that you could look at this person and tell who they was rooting for by how they was dressed, how they carried themselves, and how they shouted when something great happened to their team. And as I looked at that, I finally started to understand why is the world that as Christian folks, we can't tell a Christian from a worldly person.
Come on,
you can't
now.
Tell somebody who loves the Lord yeah. from somebody who don't love the world. Yeah. They look the same, they talk the same, they Uh-oh. Walk the same,
Uh-oh.
But there should be a difference between somebody who shouts for God yeah. and somebody that don't. I can see I ain't gonna talk to nobody this afternoon. I may as well just turn around and preach to the wall. But I'm telling you, there's a word called fanatic. And the word fanatic is that someone who was so much of a fan of something, he became an addict of what he was a fan of.
Yeah.
And if
yeah.
anybody in here wants to be a fanatic of something, we all ought to be a fanatic of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We should be radicals. We should be somebody that when they see us, they say that person is crazy, insane with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
But,
come on.
Look just like the rest of them.
Come on.
Ain't no fanatics in the church. Ain't nobody running and kicking nothing over in the church. You can't even tell them they got a cross around their neck, but they ain't shouting for nothing. You can throw a brick in the church, and that's the only way somebody's going to get the movement. Fanatic is what they call them. You can tell how somebody feels about something by how they act. It'll show up sooner or later.
Sooner or later.
If you love it, it's going to show up that you love it. Tony, I don't have to question whether or not you love Junior. It shows when you walk together. It's not a secret.
Come on now.
It's evident, Sister Gwen, mm-hmm. by how you care for your mama, mm-hmm. that you love her.
Yeah.
It's not a mystery. We don't have to scratch our heads and wonder if you love your mama or not.
Yeah.
But you come to church, people singing songs that's moving the spirit, and they ain't said a word.
Come on now. Come on.
Somebody woke you up early this morning and started you on your way. You ain't said nothing to him yet. You ain't good. You ain't even blessed the food. Where's the fanatic in the church? Well, I've come to find out that this text will teach us there's some things that we should celebrate in the presence of unbelievers. Because how you celebrate Jesus helps bring people into Christ.
Come on now.
How you carry yourself and shout unto the Lord makes a difference to somebody who doesn't know Jesus. Walk with me through the text. David is returning the ark of the Lord unto the holy city of Jerusalem.
Yes.
Now you can't miss what's happening in this setting, because Jerusalem is a city that's supposed to be set apart. It's not like Indianapolis. It ain't like Hollywood. It's a city of God that's supposed to be set apart. It's supposed to be a gathering of people that are God's most precious little ones. It's the creme de la creme of all cities. It's the greatest city on the earth. But it was without the presence of the Lord. How is it that the things that's supposed to be set apart for the Lord are the very things that's missing the presence of God?
Yeah.
How is it that which thing we go to see the Lord is where we find that God is missing? David desired to bring the presence of God into the city. And he made preparations for the movement of God to come into the city. He was sacrificing unto the Lord. He had burnt offerings which symbolized that he was unworthy for God's presence to even be there. Have you ever felt unworthy to be in God's presence? Has God ever done something for you? Say, God, I don't even feel worthy of the blessings that you give me. I don't even feel like I can even accept God's presence because I know I'm just a filthy rag. He was sacrificing abundantly unto the Lord. And I know the should be the bigger the sinner, the bigger the sacrifice. But what happens when we get around other people? We don't want them to know we are sinners. So I'm only going to sacrifice a little something to make you think I only did a little something bad. But in all reality, I should have sacrificed all that I had. I should have gave the Lord all that I had. But we want to put on the image of being more than what we are. David sacrificed so much that it couldn't be numbered what he sacrificed. He brings in the presence of the Lord. And he gets it into the city. Now should be a time of rejoicing. Now should be a time that people are celebrating what just took place. You have to understand, one of the first things we need to start thanking God for is peace. David was a man of war. He was a soldier.
Yes, he was.
And if you are a man of war and a man of soldier, a soldier, and you at peace, you better learn how to praise God for peace. For not having to fight at this particular time. Have you ever thanked God for peace?
Yes. Yes,
because sometimes all hell breaks loose in your life. And when things is calm, you need to thank God for just having some peace.
Yes,
thank God for being able to sleep at night.
David was thanking God for his peace. But people don't always quite understand why we worship the Lord like we do. Somebody's probably talking about you right now, June. Why in the world did this boy go to two services?
Yes.
It'll take two services. Somebody sitting on the lawnmower watching you go to church every Sunday saying, look at them going to church every Sunday morning. They ain't living no better than I am.
Mm-hmm.
They struggling just like I am. And they want to talk bad about somebody going to church. But there should be some fanatics about us when it comes to going to church. David here starts coming in, singing and dancing before the people. And I wonder when was the last time you went to church? Leaping, singing, and dancing. When was the last time you went into the sanctuary filled with the Holy Spirit?
Come on, come on.
You kicked the door open, so excited to be in the house of the Lord just one more Sunday afternoon. But you will find somebody went to church this morning, unlocked the door, and was mad because nobody was there when they got there.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody was mad because nobody came and cleaned the church parking lot. Somebody said the choir stand was messed up and they left all kind of chaos in the place and failed to come before his presence with singing and enter into his courts with praise. David was moving in front of the Lord with mad enthusiasm, dancing before the Lord. And he removed his kingly garment and put on a garment of a humble servant.
Yes, he did.
Sometimes we need to take off those church clothes.
Come on.
And the church attitude and come into place just humble as we know how.
Yeah.
I'm walking in just a sinner saved by grace. Yeah. I ain't no better than nobody else. I just need to be in the presence of the Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
David had this thing right. I just want to dance unto the Lord. David cut a step. Cut a rug, Sister Holly, before the presence of the Lord. Can't you see David dancing before the presence of the Lord? And his wife looks out the window and said, look at this idiot out there dancing and making a fool out of himself. And if I'm going to be a fool for anybody,
come on,
let me be a fool for Jesus.
Yeah.
If I'm going to look like an idiot to anybody, let me look like an idiot for Jesus. She didn't quite understand why David was doing the things he was doing. She didn't quite get this thing. And I wonder how many times have we just lost our mind in the presence of the Lord? Where we just found ourselves giving all that we had just to praise God's presence and praise Him for who He really is. David was cutting a step. And she began to despise him on the inside. Mama, can you imagine somebody just not liking you just because of the way you praise the Lord?
Yeah.
Somebody disliking you just because you like to shout unto the Lord? She found a reason to start disliking King David. But I like the conversation that David had with his wife. He said, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You wasn't there when He saved me. You wasn't there when He brought me out. You wasn't there when I was in the field and they came looking for a king. And my daddy didn't even call me into the house. He looked at all my other brothers. But the prophet said that must be somebody else.
That's right.
You wasn't there, Mikhail, when I was caught between the rock and a hard place.
Come on now.
When your daddy was hunting, trying to kill me.
Yeah.
You didn't quite understand why things was happening like they were.
Yeah, yeah.
You wasn't there when my son was trying to kill me to take over my kingship.
Mm-hmm.
So you quite not understand what's actually going on. You wasn't there when I took Bathsheba, another man's wife, but God still forgave me.
Come on,
you wasn't
now.
There, Bathsheba, when I was doing all kind of crazy things to people and hurting each and everybody that I could. You can't quite understand why I'm shouting like I am, because I know that God's been good to me and God's been kind.
Yeah.
So if I'm going to dance, I'm going to dance for Jesus.
Yeah.
David tells her, there's a reason that we all should dance for the Lord.
Come on now.
There's reasons that if we broke it down, we'll find out that we should have had a wacky line going on in here just this morning. There should have been dancing and singing when we walked into the place. Because you're going to have to look back and examine why David was dancing. We'll understand that every time we come, there should be a testimony in our step.
Mm-hmm.
That somebody ought to be able to look at you and say, this person had to be in the presence of the Lord.
Yes, yes.
And I wonder if we all just took a moment and had an evaluation of our life. Would that be enough to make you want to get up and start dancing? Well, I've come to give you some examples all by myself.
Come on.
Because next week we're going to celebrate my sister's birthday.
Yeah.
And as I was thinking about celebrating her birthday, I thought about there was a time we thought she might not see her next birthday.
Amen.
There was a time we was praying over her bedside, wondering if God was going to heal her body. That's one reason to start dancing right there.
Come on.
I thought about my brother one time was in a car accident.
Well.
Got thrown out the car, but he still walks around dancing all day long. That's another reason to cut a step right there.
Yes.
I thought about my mama being sick, going through operations on her eye time after time after time again. But she's still here, and he drove herself to the church.
Come on,
that's just another reason to start dancing for the Lord. I looked at Sister Harley last year. She was in the hospital. Had a stroke, but she walks in here Sunday after Sunday, pushing her own little wheelbarrow with the tennis ball on the bottom. You gotta remember, God said, I've been good to you, and I've been kind. And if you need anything to think about, just think about my goodness, and that should be a reason enough to make you start dancing and shouting.
Yeah.
That should be reason enough to make you a fanatic for the Lord. That somebody start looking at you and wondering, why are you doing what you're doing? I'm doing it because God's been good to me.
Yeah.
And God's been kind.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
He put it to her. Look what he tells her. He tells her his testimony. He said, look what God's done for me. But I don't want you to stop right there. Because he says to her, guess what, Micah? You ain't seen nothing yet. I've been dancing while I've been here. But you ain't seen nothing yet. And I wonder if anybody's been praying and asking God for something special in their life. And you've been waiting on this breakthrough to come, but you can see it on the horizon. You have faith enough to believe that God's going to do a work and it's going to perform a miracle in your life. Are you ready to cut a step when you think about what God is getting ready to do? And I have one more situation, June, that was brought to my mind. Because I remember when I had a lost brother.
Yes.
And didn't nobody know where he was. He was gone out into the wilderness.
Yes,
and we was praying that God might bring him back home.
Yeah.
And I kept on praying And I kept on seeking. And I had a feeling in my spirit that one of these old days, I was going to look down the street and see my brother stepping back home. And I remember saying, what's going to happen when my brother come home? I said, I'm going to dance a dance that ain't never been danced before. I will thank God from heaven on high for what God has done and how God has answered prayers.
Come
but
on
you ain't
now.
Seen nothing yet. Because I have a feeling that one of these old days, you're going to look for me and I'm going to be gone.
Yes.
Ain't nobody going to be left to tell you where Jerry D is. I'm going to be dancing in the presence of the Lord.
All right,
I'm
going
to be singing in the presence of the Lord. Anybody just want to be in God's presence and thank God for his goodness and thank God for his mercy? You got too much stuff to thank God for not to cut a step. I don't want nobody to say, what in the world is he dancing for? I'm dancing for the glory of the Lord. He tells him, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm going to cut a big step when God finished doing the work on my behalf. But you always got to understand, God always wants you to bless somebody else. Your testimony is for somebody else.
Yes, it is.
Your story is for somebody else. He says these female servants that you were just talking about is going to be blessed because they just experienced what God has done.
Yes.
They're going to get a better example, a better relationship with the Lord because of what has just transpired. Yeah. But as for you, you hater, you backbiters, you go on and keep on riding on your lawnmower and keep on talking about me every Sunday. You keep on saying ain't no need for doing all that. You keep on sitting on the sideline.
Yes.
You stay on over there. God says you just keep on doing what you're doing and you're going to keep on getting what you're getting.
Amen.
But because David said I've got some more stuff coming, David said I'm going to be praising the Lord like this all the time. So you may as well get used to it. You may as well just park the lawnmower out front because I'm going to be coming out here all the time and praising the Lord. As we looked at three Sundays, real worshipers. Last Sunday, we looked at up worshiping God's presence. Today we think about how there should be some inward movement inside you when you make it to the house of the Lord. There should be a change when you leave service every Sunday. Something should have happened inside you when you leave the church
Amen.
Every Sunday.
Amen.
There should be something inside of you saying, I've given all that I had to the Lord.
Yes.
I've sacrificed all that I have to the Lord. I've laid at the Lord's feet my offerings and hope that the Lord will accept what I'm trying to give unto him. And I pray that what I give him, God will accept it. I pray that God will say that my coming wasn't in vain.
Yes.
I didn't come here just for a show. I didn't come here
out
of tradition. I didn't come here just to have stuff to do. I come here to give God a just praise and a just worship. And I poured all I had into the service. I gave God the very best that I had because I realized that God has given me the very best that he has. I should be exhausted, Sister Queen, that I've given God everything that I had. God says, if you do this, I will accept your offering. I will accept